On this wildcard episode of Coding 101, we've got Gregg Pollack, founder of Code School. It's time to get geeky.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Coding 101 is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This episode of Coding 101 is brought to you by Lynda.com. Lynda.com is an easy and affordable way to help you learn. Instantly stream thousands of courses created by experts on business, software, web development, graphic design, and more. For a free trial, visit lynda.com/C101. That's lynda.com/C101. And by Mandrill. Mandrill is a scalable, reliable, and secure email infrastructure service trusted by more than 300,000 customers. Sign up at mandrill.com, promo code TWIT, and you'll receive 50,000 free email sends per month for your first 6 months of service. Welcome to Coding 101. It's the Twitch show where we let you into the wonderful world of the Code Monkey. I'm Father Robert Ballecer, the Digital Jesuit, here with Gregg Pollack, the founder of Code School. Gregg, thank you very much for coming onto the show.
Thank you for inviting me. It's great to be here.
Now, we do these episodes as it's a nice little change from what we get in our regular weeks of Coding 101, which is we do some hardcore coding. But every once in a while, we like to stop and listen to the people behind the code, the people who either teach it, who do it in the real world, or who actually write the software's tools and suites that we use to create the code that runs the world. You're here specifically because you've got a little bit of a creative enterprise that has been encouraging people to get into the world of coding. But we'll talk about that in a bit. What I want to do first is I want to talk about you. Can you tell the folks at home, Who are you? Who is Gregg Pollack? Where do you come from? And why do you find yourself at the head of a code teaching empire?
Well, sure. Well, you and me went to the same college. We both went to Santa Clara University, so I have a computer engineering background. Thought I wanted to go into video games. That didn't turn out totally, but I learned about this hot new language named Java. And I learned some Java, got a Java job for a while, got a Perl job for a while, ended up moving to Orlando, doing some consulting work. Along those ways, I had two startups that I tried to do. They both failed. And then I started doing consulting here, and I started building web applications, learned about this hot new technology called Ruby on Rails, really got into that with the consulting work, and then also realized around that same time that I really enjoyed creating ways to teach programmers, whether it's doing podcasts, doing videos, doing blog posts. You know, I really enjoyed and got a lot of positive feedback from educating developers. And a few years later into the consulting, I started this thing called Code School, which allows people to learn different coding techniques online. That's my story in a nutshell.
Well, let's crack open that nutshell a little bit, because there's actually a lot in there. Let's go back even before you got to Santa Clara University. Both of us were there in the computer science department. Like you, I loved programming. I kind of wanted to take it in a slightly different direction. I also started thinking I wanted to design games, but eventually I was weaned off of that. When you think about the time before Santa Clara University, mm-hmm. do you remember what got you into computers in the first place?
That would be my dad. Fred Pollack, he was a computer engineer at Intel for 25 years and sort of worked his way up as an engineer, eventually becoming a fellow. And I believe he was the head of the R&D department there for a little while. So I was surrounded by computers growing up. I was always fascinated by them. Eventually, got one in my own room and hacked around a lot on the old days with doing BBSs and all that sort of stuff. So I was always really into it, got into web pages, but it was just something I always gravitated towards.
You're the second straight guest who has talked about BBSs. And there's a whole new generation now that has never had to do a BBS, has never had to dial up, actually. And mm-hmm. It's interesting what might be your experience of that BBS web page crossover. Because I remember the first time I was able to write a web page when I was at Santa Clara, and they were trying to explain it to me. They're like, oh, well, it's like a BBS, but this can be accessed by people all over the world. And it was there was a subtle shift there. It's like, oh, okay, so it's the same idea, but suddenly I've got this common scripting language and I can use it anywhere. Do you remember right. the first time you wrote a web page?
Oh, certainly. Yeah, BBSs were the social networks of the 80s, weren't they? It was how you connected with other people across, you know, on your computer, minus email, but it was more of a social thing. But with web pages, I started doing web pages, yeah, back in maybe my senior year of high school and then into college. Created a homepage back then, and not like I've heard other people that work for me where they've, you know, they managed to get a job. I don't have any really good stories about that, but started hacking up HTML and CSS as soon as we were able to get an ISP that provided you a free opportunity to have a web page.
I got to ask this. Did you have a CompuServe account?
CompuServe, yeah. CompuServe, Prodigy. I remember Prodigy. CompuServe.
Yes. CompuServe, Prodigy, and AOL. I mean, those were sort of the professional bulletin board systems. We had BBSs that you might be local. And I remember the first time I found a local BBS in my city that I could call without a long distance charge, I was over the moon. And the first time I created a BBS, I would sit there and just wait for the activity lights on my modems to flicker because I wanted someone connected. And then you got AOL, you got Prodigy, you got CompuServe, and you realized I can be connected to a lot more people than I can just over dial-up. I think it really, it defined a transition within a generation of this computer science stuff isn't just a hobby. It's not just something I do for fun. It's something I can do a career in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. I remember back then, I was always, you know, trying to find the BBSs with all the information on the hacker stuff and, having fun. I remember hacking phone voicemail systems with friends of mine and just wreaking havoc. It was crazy.
I think the number one thing that was downloaded from my BBS was the Anarchy Cookbook.
I remember that.
Remember that? Yeah. And that had everything from, you know, how to do the 2600 tone, to hack telephone systems, to how to make bombs. That was where I learned how to make thermite. So, I mean, it was a weird, weird time. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like all the worst of the internet, but without the internet.
Yeah, it is really interesting to think back to that sort of stuff and how similar things are now. I mean, even back then, you had kind of things that resembled massively multiplayer online games. Even back then with the BBSs, you know, they would plug these games into the BBSs and you'd go on there and every day you would get a new set of ships that you could set up defending your planet and attack other people's planets, very much like you can today.
Wait. Did you play Trade Wars on a BBS?
I was trying to figure out what that name was. Yeah, that's it. Trade Wars. That was totally, I was just, yeah, sucked
I was
in
hooked.
By that.
I was hooked. I was one of these kids who, I was on a board that actually allowed for multiple moves per day. So if you didn't keep calling back in, you would miss your moves and people would kill you. Well, again, that's the second straight week we've had someone on who has talked about BBSs and Trade Wars. That's fantastic.
Nice.
All right, now, so take me through this. Obviously, you grew up with computers because your father was heavily involved with them.
Mm-hmm.
When did you notice that transition from a computer was nice to have and it was interesting and the geeks used it and the nerds used it to everyone's got this now. Everyone needs to use a computer. Otherwise, you get left behind.
When did I notice that if there was a point where everyone needs a computer? I don't know if I was that globally plugged in to the mentality of the world, but definitely going into college. I mean, by the time I got to college, everybody had their own computers. So
yeah,
maybe there's that.
That was a thing.
What do you think?
For me, I think it was actually after I had already entered the priesthood. So like near 1994, 1994, 1995 was when universities, of course, had access to the internet. But then you started having access to the internet from companies other than AOL and Prodigy because they gave you kind of the internet. But now you had local companies that were setting up where you could dial in and you were just on the internet and you could go anywhere on the internet. I remember the first time I found Gopher. Did you ever use Gopher to download legal material?
Oh, definitely not. Yeah, no, of course not.
All right, let's pull out just a tiny bit. Now, you're at Santa Clara University, You're studying computer science because you're thinking about going into game development. You talked about maybe you didn't want to do that. What turned you away from the world of game development?
Bottom line is I never had a good mentor. Like so many other developers that I talked to, I had an unfortunate series of bosses and really never had anyone that helped me harness my talent and my passion for computer science and programming. Went to the game company, tried to do that, but I just got shoehorned because nobody really took me under their wing and showed me how to do things. So my passion went elsewhere. I mean, at the time I was really into online gaming, you know, with games like Quake and Doom and all that sort of stuff. And so much so that I had, you know, a clan and we'd play in online tournaments. And I saw those online tournaments. It's like, yeah, that's really interesting. They're using same sort of online web application technology that I just learned how to program. Let me see if I can do that. And that was actually the first startup that I tried to create. It was called Gaming Leagues. And it allowed, it was sort of a freemium business where anybody could create their own online tournament leagues for any games. And it was a great piece of software. But the unfortunate part of the story is I didn't know crap about sales and marketing, nor is that in my blood to really enjoy doing stuff like that. So that business didn't work out.
Right. I'm here with Gregg Pollack, the founder of Code School. We'll be right back. But first, I wanted to take some time to talk about the first sponsor of this episode of Coding 101. We've had them on the show a lot. You know them. You love them. It's lynda.com. Now, what is lynda.com? Lynda.com is a one-stop shop, a repository for knowledge on the internet. And it's one of the tools that we suggest to the people who watch Coding 101 or any of the shows on the Twit TV network. And that's because whether you're a beginner, advanced, intermediate, whatever your skill level might be, there's something on lynda.com for you. Even if you already know the subject, it's a great way to go back and find those little bits and pieces that maybe need a refresher. Now, lynda.com is an easy and affordable way to help you learn. You can instantly stream thousands of courses created by experts on software, web development, graphic design, and more. It works directly with industry experts and software companies to provide timely training, often the same day that new versions or releases hit the market, so that you're always up to speed. All courses on lynda.com are produced at the highest quality. This is important. You don't want to start watching a series on a subject that you desperately need if the audio's not right, or if the camera work is horrible, or if they don't use the right lighting. I mean, that's all superficial, but if it gets in the way of the learning, it's important. That's why lynda.com is always produced professionally. They also include tools like searchable transcripts and playlists and certificates of course completion, which you can publish to your LinkedIn profile. All these things help you to find what you need to know when you need to know it. Whether you're beginner, advanced, intermediate, lynda.com has courses for all experience levels. You can learn while you're on the go with the lynda.com app for iOS and Android, and one low monthly price of $25 gives you unlimited access to over 100,000 video tutorials. Premium plan members can also download project files and practice along with the instructor, and premium members with an annual plan can download courses to watch offline, which makes lynda.com the ultimate resource for knowledge. Lynda.com has a series of tutorials on the foundations of programming, including courses on fundamentals, databases, object-oriented design, and more. There's also the Code Clinic series, where lynda.com authors solve monthly challenges using different programming languages, including Python, Java, PHP, C++, and Ruby. Whether you're completely new to coding, want to learn a new programming language, or just sharpen your skills, lynda.com has got you covered. For any software you rely on, lynda.com can help you stay current with all software updates and learn the ins and outs to be more efficient and productive. And we've got a special offer just for you to access all the courses free for 10 days. Visit lynda.com/C101 to try lynda.com free for 10 days. That's lynda.com/C101. lynda.com/C101. And we thank Lynda for their support of Coding 101. I'm back with Gregg Pollack, the founder of Code School. Gregg, you talked a little bit about this new language that came up when you were at Santa Clara, this Java. And actually, that was I was kind of gone by the time that started becoming popular. When I was there, I was learning C++. I was in the Borland tool, so also assembly. What was it like? Because I remember the promise of Java. The whole idea was, oh, You're going to write it once and it will work on everything forever, all the time. What was right. the promise made to you that sucked you into Java?
Well, at the time, it was the new hotness when it came to programming languages. I did learn C++ in college. And then I took, I think there was maybe one or maybe two courses where it went into Java and Java servlets. But you're exactly right. That's what it was. So what it was touted is that here was this language that you could run across all these different operating systems and run the same code. And that was the new hotness.
Yeah. Java gets a really bad rap for being insecure and for being crashy and for being a resource hog. Go down the line and every programmer who has ever worked with Java is going to have some gripe about the language. But
don't they say that about all the languages?
Exactly. That's what I was about to ask. Do you think that Java gets unfairly booted over what is essentially people just using it wrong?
I think you can say that about every language. There's negatives, positive and negatives about all the different languages, and you can use them all poorly. Especially with the new interpreted, I mean, the biggest argument is, you know, with the new interpreted languages, that's the biggest thing you can point out and go, yeah, well, you know, Ruby and Python, they're not as fast as these compiled languages like C and Java. But when it comes down to it, it really doesn't matter for 99% of the time.
Yeah, yeah. And I think you've got that dead on, which is you can pick out the worst attribute of any language and make that the reason why you hate the language. But then that misses off on the things that that language does exceptionally well. And if it's going to become a popular language, there's got to be some reason why it's become popular. Something that it does well, something that it does quickly, something that it does efficiently. What would you say is Java's strength?
I don't think I'm the right person to ask about that. But the bottom line is, when it comes to being a software craftsman, it's your job to make sure that you use the right tool for the job, whether that's Java, Ruby, Python. And there's plenty of reasons to use any of them. It could have something to do with a library that one of them has, or support for that someone of them has, or, you know, a graphing library. It could be all sorts of reasons. You just got to make sure you use the best tool for the job. And try not to be too biased by your natural tendencies to pick the familiar.
Right. Let's skip forward just a tiny bit, because we've talked about your college years, we've talked about your choices in languages, but now let's talk a little bit about Code School. Let's talk about Envy Labs. You founded Envy Labs, and then you founded Code School. What are those organizations about? I mean, Envy Labs is an interesting place, because it seems to be a collection of creatives who have very widely disparate disciplines.
So Envy Labs was just the rebranding of a consultancy, sort of reinventing. When I first moved to Orlando, I created a consultancy called Patch Software, and then I created another one called Rails Envy, and then Envy Labs was the evolution from there. And basically, Envy Labs, you know, I kind of started it out with two purposes. The first was to create the best environment for software developers, you know, pay them well, have fun while we're doing it, trust them to do good work. And the second reason that we sort of was the reason we did good work there was to figure out the most honest and transparent way to do consulting work. Because, you know, as developers, people, you know, who like building stuff, we're not always the best communicators. So I tried to figure out what are the processes I can put in place to maintain a high level of transparency between what we're doing and what our clients are doing. And we sort of innovated on that. And I was lucky enough that, you know, when I started blogging and podcasting and going and speaking at conferences, that led to finding more work. People would come our way, and Ruby on Rails was also a new technology. You know, that's one way that you can drum up good business is pick a new technology and a niche technology that not too many people know yet and sort of advertise that you can help with that. So that's what we did. And we were lucky enough to get some good clients. We started with just four guys in an office, and then we grew to about, I think, maybe between 16 and 20 before we launched our first product, Code School. And we were lucky enough that, you know, since we were making enough money from the consultancy, that we could afford to try to create a product. And it was funded by the consultancy. So Code School now employ, I mean, Envy Labs now is a separate entity. Envy Labs has about 13 people there that work and still do consulting work. And Code School has about 35 people that work separately. And they both work next to each other as two different organizations. And we've never had to take any funding. It was all bootstrapped. We've been pretty lucky in that respect.
Let's talk about Code School, because it's actually been very popular to create coding mm-hmm. boot camps. I've seen so many pop up over just the last 5 years.
Sure.
Code School, I like your curriculum. I like the way that you handle it. I like your menu of options for people who are interested. Can you describe what you think makes Code School different than
sure,
what
definitely.
Else you might find?
Sure. Yeah. What I'm most passionate about is really figuring out the most effective way to teach new technologies. That's what I've always done when I was doing blogging. I would go speak at conferences. And I realized that, you know, I put out videos, and every couple months I put out more free videos. Sometimes I get them sponsored by other companies. I put out these educational videos where I'd have fun with green screens. And then we also sort of started looking at TryRuby. TryRuby was one of these in-browser coding things that was around long before Codecademy was out there. And so at one point we were like, hey, what would happen if we put together the videos that I enjoy producing, the green screen videos, with that coding in the browser? And what if we gamified it? And how would it look like if it was gamified? So we came up with Code School, where what we do every time we go to approach a new topic is we create a whole new theme, because we want you to feel like, you know, you're walking into a game spot and you're picking a game off the shelf and it has an entirely new theme. And then when we go to teach it, we ask ourselves, okay, how can we teach this in the most effective way? Not just showing somebody a talking head, not just showing somebody's screen and they walk you through it, but how can we really explain some of these hard to understand technical topics in a very engaging and entertaining way? And so what we do, each course on Code School might take you about 4 hours to complete, but you'll first watch a 5 to 10 minute video, and then you'll immediately have to go into the browser, do some coding challenges right there in the browser in order to get to the next level. So we make you prove that you really understood what we were talking about. And what's interesting is that between courses, you'll notice that the interface for playing the course and the interface for solving the challenges and coding, it changes. Because even amongst programming languages and even frameworks in those programming languages, the optimal way to learn and the optimal way to code in those in a learning tool changes. So what's innovative really about Code School is how we put together so many different disciplines to create one final product, one final course. And I suspect we spend more than anybody does out there for a single course, because we need to make sure we've got instructional design, good development, good design, good branding, good videography. We even bring in a jingle writer, so we have somebody do a jingle for it. We have to have good badges that people want to earn. So, and you know, it has to be gamified. So we add that with gamification to make a learning experience, which is hopefully most effective. So the next time a developer thinks, hey, I want to pick up that new technology, should I look and see if there's a book? Well, maybe first I'll see if there's a Code School course first, because I think that'll probably be the most entertaining way and most effective use of my time to pick up that subject.
You're great.
But we don't have drones, not like Linda.
No.
That's how, when you did that plug, I was just like, right in the middle, I was like, drones. You're talking. All I heard was drones. Drones.
We're ODing on drones here at the studio right now. So it's kind of, we got drones on the brain. What I like about that, I like this gamification of the learning process. One of the things that we get in feedback, not just here, but in some of my other jobs where I'm actually teaching people how to program, is I get criticism from some of the older school teachers who are saying, well, no, you know, if you're going to teach someone programming, you give them all the theory and you give them this and this and this and this layer and this layer and this layer. And I look at their curriculum and we might be going 18 months in before someone writes something that's actually usable in the outside world. It sounds to me as if Code School is going in a different direction, where you want to give someone a goal at the beginning of a path. You want to say, look, I'm going to show you how to design something for iOS, and you're going to pick up these markers as you go along to prove that you have the knowledge, that you're accumulating it from the classes that we're giving you. And at the end, you will have something palatable that you can hold up and say, I created this.
Right. The idea.
Yeah, it's a different way of learning.
Yeah. The idea that, you know, your job is to sit in a classroom and a teacher is going to lecture at you for an hour and you need to be able to absorb all that information so you can go do something with it. Like, that's horrible. I slept through most of my college classes because of that. And really, like, if they would have taught more like what we do at Code School, I probably would have been more engaged. You know, teach me a single subject and then let's use it. Let's do it together. And we work a lot at Code School with the coding boot camps. A lot of these new coding boot camps that pop up because they use our content as a textbook. They use it to reverse the classroom. So before they even show up, they'll say, go take this Code School course and, you know, we'll see you tomorrow. And people show up and they might go over the syntax that we're taught in that course, but then they get to spend more time doing what is best. The time in the classroom is best spent not being lectured at, but actually building stuff with other people, which is where time should be spent in the classroom, which is the best use of time. You know, what do you think?
Yeah, I'm absolutely down with that. And ultimately, what you want is you want to have many different ways for people to learn. Mm-hmm. Something that I've picked up as years of being an educator is, if you're expecting every student to learn the same way, you're going to be sorely disappointed. And so if you don't give people different ways to learn the same information differently, you're always going to lose someone. Someone's just not going to get it. Someone will not be able to understand the lesson.
Yeah, you know, there was actually some research that came out recently, I can't cite it offhand, that showed that assumption that some people that people learn in different ways is a little bit faulty. It doesn't really stand up when you get down to it. There's certain common ways that you can really engage the majority of people. And we're still figuring that out. And I think that's where there's a lot of innovation left to be had when it comes to learning online. You know, you see all of the universities trying to go online, but they're just bringing the lectures online. It's nothing engaging. They're not taking the extra time to fully utilize multimedia and interactivity. It's getting closer, but it's still not there. And there's more that you can do. And that's why, you know, if you haven't checked out, not to do some shameless self-promotion, but we got a lot of free content over on Code School. A lot of, if you want to check out Rails, we've got Rails for Zombies. If you want to check out Ruby, we've got Try Ruby. We've got tons of free content. And most of our content has a first free level if it's not all free. So go over there and check it out. And also Angular. Angular is really hot right now as well. I'm sure we were going to talk about that at some point. But we worked with Google to put together an Angular course that's completely free to get you up to speed.
Gregg, I want you to step into the shoes of a prospective student.
Sure.
And let's make this person a complete noob. This person, obviously a millennial, understands computers or knows how to use a computer. But he or she has never programmed. He or she has never even thought about programming until he or she wandered onto Code School. What do you want to be their experience as they're scrolling through the paths, as they're scrolling through the courses that are available? What are you hoping that they'll experience that will say, oh, okay, this is what I want to do. I want to develop an iOS app, or I want to create a web page, or I want to be able to do something in Swift. What's your gateway for this?
Right. Well, there's two different questions that you maybe are at. And let me know which one you want me to answer. The first question is, what do I recommend people who are thinking about learning program do? And then the second question is, you know, what do I want people to get out of Code School? And why do I think they'll be more successful there? Which one do you think?
Well, let's take them one after the other.
Sure. Well, if you want to become a programmer, the first step is to figure out something that you want to build, figure out a problem you want to solve. This could be creating a, you know, website for your uncle's store, or it could be creating a homepage for your cat, or it could be a cat washing business. So figure out something that you want to build. It could be an iPhone app. Then you gotta look into what technologies do you need to learn to do that. Obviously, if you want to create an iPhone app, you need to go into iOS and Objective-C. If you want to do a web page, then you need to learn HTML and CSS. So you gotta figure out what you need to learn in order to accomplish what you want to accomplish. Then once you figure that out, you can dive into a subject. Maybe we'll have it on Code School. Maybe it'll get you started. But what's important is that you stick with that and you try to build that project as you go. I mean, the most successful learners have that vision of something they want to build. And so they have that passion because they have purpose. So find a purpose. The second thing I would say, or third, I guess, would I say from people learning how to code is find where you can go and surround yourself with other programmers. You might have a friend that's a programmer, but if you live in a big city, odds are you have some great users groups, right? So these are meetup groups where other craftsmen hang out. So see if you can go and hang out with other developers. That way you have a support network. The other thing you might want to do, if you're pretty serious about it, is it depends on how much money you want to spend, right? Is figure out how much money you can spend to learn and how much of a sacrifice you can make in your time. So if money is no object and you want to learn how to code, the best way to do it is to find a boot camp. Look for ones like you've got like General Assembly, you've got Flatiron School, you've got a bunch of these, you know, you've got, boot camp, dev boot camp, you've got Iron Yard, some really great developer boot camps have been popping up over the last year. And, you know, you'll be spending between 10 and 15 grand, but it'll be a great education. It'll take you 3 or 4 months of time. You'll come out the other end a hireable beginner, junior programmer, or at least an intern. So if you've got a lot of money, you can do that. If you've got a little less money, maybe you can do like $500 a month. You want to look at these two websites. There's only two right now that really do this really well, and that is Thinkful or Block.io. And for these guys, you're going to spend a couple $100 a month. It's going to be all online, not in person, but they're going to give you a great curriculum and pair you up with a mentor that you get to talk with quite often. So, it looks like we're looking at Thinkful. Yeah, check that out. So you get to talk with your mentor. They lead you through the curriculum. And that's really good if you can afford to spend a couple $100 a month, if you're that serious. And if you're a kind of person that needs somebody to assign you to do work who is, you know, making sure that you get it done and is checking in with you, then that might be a good alternative. If you don't want to spend that much, maybe it's only, let's say, $29 a month, maybe check out Code School. Maybe also check out lynda.com. Maybe also check out Pluralsight. Maybe also check out treehouse.com. All of these are relatively inexpensive ways to learn online. And, you know, if you want to learn a discipline, like if I wanted to learn how to trade in the stock market, do you think I could just read one stock market book and I would know everything that I need to know? Probably not. You're going to need to learn from multiple resources. And that's why you might want to get a subscription to, say, Lynda and Code School and Pluralsight and Treehouse, because you're not going to really get everything the first time. And we all have our strengths. And so you might spend $100 a month instead of a couple $100 a month, but have access to all these great tutorials because they're all pretty awesome. Yeah. So I guess that that was a lot of answers to questions that you didn't ask.
That's fantastic. I love that plurality of information. I mean, that's one of the strengths of this internet generation, which is you can pull in information from so many different sources, and one of them will match the way that you learn, and that's great. But if you don't mind, when we come back from the break, I want to talk about this concept that you've brought up twice now, and it's the idea of mentorship, because I think that element is not considered enough by people who want to get into programming, and that's why I see a lot of fall off. People who say they want to get into programming and then they lose interest. And I think you're dead on in that. A mentor can make all the difference. Can we talk about that after the break?
Sounds good. And I also have a few confessions to make, Father.
Oh, we'll have that at the end of the show.
Okay, sounds good.
Before we go there, though, let's take just a short break to thank the second sponsor of this episode of Coding 101, and it's Mandrill. Now, I know a lot of attention these days is being paid to the latest in social, the latest collaboration tool, the latest suite for communication. But, you know, if you consider what happens in business, what happens in the enterprise, what really happens when work needs to occur, it always comes back to email. And, well, Mandrill is a scalable, reliable, and secure email infrastructure service that is trusted by more than 300,000 customers. Mandrill is easy to set up and integrate with your existing apps, and it's fast. It allows you to integrate, deliver, track, and analyze. It gives you detailed delivery reports, advanced analytics, and a friendly interface that means that your entire team, from developers to marketers, can easily monitor and evaluate email performance. With servers all over the world, Mandrill can deliver your email in milliseconds. It started as an idea back in 2010, but now it's growing fast and innovating faster. Mandrill is now the largest email as a service platform on the market. You can use Mandrel to send automated one-to-one emails like password resets and welcome messages, as well as marketing emails and customized newsletters. They made it for developers, and developers love documentation. Developers love integration, high delivery rates, webhooks, and analytics, and that's all built into the package. It comes with a beautiful interface, flexible template options, custom tagging, and advanced tracking and reports. Mandrel is the only email infrastructure service with a mobile app that lets you monitor delivery and troubleshoot from wherever you are. Now, if you are even remotely interested in having your email service being taken up to the next level, we want you to try Mandrel. It's powerful, scalable, and affordable, but you don't have to take our word for it. Right now, Mandrel is offering the TWIT audience a special deal. Sign up at mandrel.com, promo code TWIT, and you'll receive 50,000 free email sends per month for your first 6 months of service. That's mandrel.com, promo code TWIT, mandrill.com, promo code TWIT. And we thank Mandrel for their support of Coding 101. We're back with Gregg Pollack, the founder of Code School. We're going to talk a little bit about mentorship. Now, Gregg, at the beginning of this episode, you talked about drifting away from video game programming because you didn't have a mentor who really challenged you. And then when I asked you about how people can learn, one of the things that you mentioned, an option, was to have a mentor, someone who would do more than just collect homework, but actually ask the difficult questions. What do you think those difficult questions are? What's the job of a mentor? To sit down with someone who may be brand new at programming and to push him or her, question him or her, challenge him or her, what do they do?
Well, I was going to say, I don't think it's so much about being challenged as much as having someone to ask questions to. One of the reasons why I think, you know, we try to make Code School a place to get started is because when you first pick up a new technology, if you're going to fail, it's going to happen in the first 30 minutes because you can't install it, you can't configure it right, and you're missing a darn semicolon. You're going to get stuck, especially when you first start out. And you're going to have a lot of stumbling blocks because the tools aren't always simple. Having that person you can go to when you run into problems, I think, is the most valuable thing you could possibly have. So I think that's really the role, in my opinion, that's the biggest role of a mentor, is having someone you can go to when you get stuck, because you're going to get stuck several times and you need to have the right personality to deal with that. You got to be able to enjoy solving really complex problems. And I think that's the biggest thing. As far as having somebody that points you in the right direction, it's always good if you have somebody who's already learned something so they can paint you down the right path and tell you what to learn.
Right, right. I think along with that, the best mentors that I've seen have been able to really force their mentees to ask of themselves, why are you doing this? Because, you know, as you mentioned, you want to get into programming to solve a problem. You want to start programming because you want it to do something. Sometimes people will come into this thinking, well, I want a career. That's not enough. Unless you actually understand that you want to use your knowledge, this knowledge that you're acquiring, to do something, it's not going to sustain you. And I think, you know, that's something that I've seen good mentors do. Let me ask you this. If you have someone who, again, is brand new into the game, into coding, and you've already given them the advice about finding the right service, maybe having a mentor, maybe go shopping around the internet to look at the different online resources so that they can figure out whether or not this is something they want to do, something they're capable of doing, something they have the aptitude to do. What's next? So let's say someone goes through a path and completes it, shows proficiency. Mm-hmm. What's the next step?
Build stuff. That's it. I mean, it goes back to, what is it, Malcolm Gladwell, the tipping point. You know, you've got to practice, right? The best musicians aren't there because they were born with it. They put in hundreds and thousands of hours of practice. So really, when it comes down to it, is you need to build stuff. I mean, that's how you teach yourself on your own. That's how people get hired without a college degree, is because they, in their spare time, built things with what they learned, so much so that they could show potential employers, look what I built.
Fantastic. Gregg Pollack, founder of Code School, with some sage advice. Hey, if you want to code, go build stuff. Gregg, I want to thank you.
Can I give you my confessions? I can't get, I saved them up.
Okay, but go.
Ready?
Go.
Okay.
Good.
So I have a few things to confess, Father. Number one, I didn't write any tests for my code. I might have broken the build. I might have used some software that wasn't really open source. I accidentally checked in all the passwords into our source control system, which I might have stored in plain text. And lastly, I wrote it all in this new programming language that I invented, so I kind of might be the only person that can do it.
You're missing one big one. I didn't document anything. I didn't comment anything. That's the big one for me. Anytime I see beautiful code that has no comments, I just want to just cry. I just want to say, I don't know what you did. That's actually a pretty good list. Gregg, I do want to give you some time here. This is your plug time. Tell folks where they can find you, where they can find Code School, where they can find your work on the internet.
Well, yeah. I mean, just head over to codeschool.com. If you've learned, if you've heard about Ruby and Rails and you've heard people talk about it, a great way to get started with web application development, check out Rails for Zombies. It's a free, completely free course to get you up to speed with Rails and see if you dig it. If you want, or if you're into JavaScript, and JavaScript is the hot new language, everybody needs to learn JavaScript, head over to our JavaScript path, and there you will find the JavaScript Road Trip 1. And it is, JavaScript Road Trip 1. And in there, it's a completely free course that gets you started programming. So this is a really good beginner course from somebody starting from scratch, learning JavaScript. So check that out. Also, if you want to learn Git, we have a Git path as well. I mean, everybody needs to learn Git to check in their code. We've got like 4 courses on Git, from Try Git to Git Real to Git Real 2. And then finally, we recently put out one called Mastering GitHub, which will teach you some of the secrets of GitHub and how to use and collaborate with other people around your source code using that service effectively. If you want to get into iOS, you want to code iPhone apps, we also have Try Objective-C. It's a free course to teach you the Objective-C language, as well as Try iOS, which will actually get you learning how to program iPhone apps right there in the browser without having to download Xcode. So you can see if it's something you really want to learn and you really are gung-ho about learning the iOS API, which is not easy. And then lastly, of course, we have our HTML and CSS path up there, which will go through all the basics you need to get up to speed with HTML and CSS. We recently put out a front-end foundations course, which will get you from the ground up, even if you don't know any HTML or CSS. That's where you start, but that course isn't free on that side. Sorry to say it. We've got some really great courses, from design stuff. So there's a fundamentals of design course if you really want to get more in design, to SaaS if you want to learn about SaaS. We've got some CoffeeScript flying around. So we've got some, if you want to learn, what else is there? Backbone, a lot of these JavaScript frameworks that are hotness around these days. We have Backbone, Ember, and Angular, the 3 most popular JavaScript frameworks out there. And we've got some courses to get you up to speed. No configuration needed. You can just jump in and start coding. That's Code School.
Gregg Pollack, thank you very much. Make sure that you head over to Code School and see the wonderful empire of code that he's put together. I want to thank you for spending some time with Coding 101. We'd love to invite you back at some point, or a representative of Code School, to guide us through a project or two. Do you think that's something that maybe you might be interested in doing?
Oh, certainly. That would be amazing. I was looking at your previous episode. I saw some C# and Perl flying around.
Yeah.
Perl? Really?
Oh, careful. We've got a Perl programmer on staff. He'll take umbrage to that.
Hey, I learned Perl. But no, it's fine. That would be cool. I mean, be happy to do it. If you're looking for some Ruby and Rails, it'd be fun to lead you guys through a Rails project.
Oh, absolutely. We haven't had anyone on for Ruby for Rails yet, so that's definitely something that's on our checklist.
Awesome.
Gregg Pollack, thank you very much.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Now, folks, don't forget that we do this show live every Thursday at 1:30 Pacific time at live.twit.tv. It's one of the things that people will do when they're a member of the Twit Army, and that's just watch the stream so you can see the pre-show, the post-show, all the bloopers that go on in between, everything that gets taken out in the final wash. It's a little experiment in the avant-garde theater that is Twit TV. Also, as long as you're going to be watching live, why not jump into our chat room at live.twit.tv? It's a good way to chat with us as we're going through the show. It's the interaction is a little limited during the interview sections, but next week we're going to be getting back into programming in a little programming project, and we definitely want to take your questions as we go so that we know where you need us to focus our attention. Don't forget that you could always drop by our show page at twit.tv/code. That will take you to the Coding 101 page, where you'll be able to find not just all of our episodes and the show notes for those episodes, which are important because they also include links to the asset files and the GitHub repositories, so you can get the code for that particular episode, but also drop-down menus that you can use to subscribe so that Coding 101 is automatically downloaded into the device of choice. And don't forget, we've got a Google Plus group at plus.google.com/twitcoding101. If you drop in there and join the community, you'll be able to ask questions, answer questions, and just participate in the conversation that makes Coding 101 not just a show, but a community of folks who are interested in how code works. Now, don't forget, you can find me on Twitter at twitter.com/PadreSJ. If you follow me there, not only will you find out what we're going to be doing for every episode of Coding 101, but you'll see what I'm doing on all the other shows I do on the Twit TV network. That includes This Week in Enterprise Tech on Mondays, Tuesdays for Padre's Corner, and Thursdays, a double dose of DIY with know-how and Coding 101. I want to thank everyone who made this show possible, to Lisa, to Leo, and of course to my super technical director, Mr. Brian Cranky Hippo Burnett. Brian, can you tell the folks a little bit about yourself and where they can find you on the Twit TV network?
Oh, well, yeah, they can find me on KnowHow doing DIY stuff with you. And if you saw that Linda ad earlier with drones, that's what we're playing with.
That's what
this
we do.
This is my little custom paint job I did earlier, so tune in for that.
That's why we've got drones on the brain. Thank you, Cranky Hippo. Remember, next week we're going to be getting back into coding. We're going to be on the other side of the studio actually taking you through a project. These wildcard episodes are fun, but we got to get back to our roots. Until then, I'm Father Robert Ballecer. End of line.